This is your host, Mary Jam from Mary Jam's Ghostly Adventures, and unfortunately the audio that I recorded at Dallas Road didn't turn out because of the background noises, and no matter how much editing I do, it will match the video, but it probably won't, even though it was my second time that I was there. But now I know background noises, especially the cars, it's really hard to record a story sometimes at a location. But I do have the video, so I'm gonna hopefully line this up with that, and hopefully you still enjoy it. So again, this is from Ghost Stories and Mysterious Creatures of British Columbia by Barbara Smith, and it's called Historically Haunted in Victoria. The properties along Dallas Road in Victoria, with their unobstructed view of Jean Dufresne in the foreground and the mountains of Washington State in the background, have long been acknowledged as among the most desirable pieces of real estate in Canada. If the scenery from these vantage points is a treat to behold today, we can only imagine how squat that same paranormal must have been more than 100 years ago. Again, I'm also reading this word for word, so I do apologize if I pronounce any of the words wrong, but some of them are kind of hard to say. The presence of such extraordinary natural beauty makes the long-ago events surrounding publisher George Nass even more prominent. Very soon after he built a large home at a certain Dallas Road address, the province gold boom of the mid-1800s turned to bust and he lost a government contract to publish the provincial Gazette, thrusting Nass into poverty. He abandoned his residence, some say without ever living in it, and fled to start a life anew in Australia. The property, which stood on what used to be the Hudson Bay Company Berkeley Farm, sat empty for some time. If there were any children in the neighborhood, they might well have invented stories about the old Nass's place being haunted, because after not too many months, it certainly looked the part. The one grand structure quickly deteriorated and acquired a shabby, foreboding appearance. However, it was another 2 years before the house actually became haunted. It is not only haunted, but apparently cursed as well. This part of the story began early in 1872 when the steamer Prince Albert sailed into Victoria Harbor from San Francisco, carrying immigrants to the island community. Victorians turned out in great numbers to welcome the ship and her passengers. Many of those standing on the dock that day had relatives on board whom they looked forward to helping settle in the growing community. As the tiny dark speck on the horizon became the discernible shape of a ship about to put into port, something of a party atmosphere pervaded those awaiting. Sadly, the feelings of jubilation were soon dashed. The Prince Albert was making her way into the harbor with a yellow flag flying from her yard. Everyone who saw the marker instantly understood its implication. Soul stricken, it was smallpox were on board. The ship docked only long enough for the Victoria-bound passengers to disembark and to disgorge all the sick and dying. It didn't matter whether these later pathetic folks had intended to go further up island or not. The rule was that if a passenger was ill, he or she was escorted off the ship at the next port of call. Through that predicament eliminated most of the anxiety for the Prince Albert's crew. It certainly created an entirely new set of problems for authorities in Victoria. What were they to do with these patients? Eventually, someone suggested that they might be safely quarantined in the abandoned house on the Berkeley Farm, and so they were. As the ship's captain had done, city officials in charge of such matters flew a yellow flag from the second building. The banner would serve as a warning to all that, to use the euphemism of the day, this was a pest house. The cold, hard truth was that entering the house would bring a visitor into certain contact with the killer disease that was then raving much of the world's population. Initially, there were 7 patients isolated in the Nazis' former home, but an 8th victim disembarked from the Prince Albert's on the return from Nanaimo. This one was a member of the ship's crew. Soon, the head count at the large home was back down to 7. However, when on June 23, 1872, a youngster named Bertha Whitney succumbed to the disease, her body was interred in an unmarked grave at Berkeley Farm. Young Bertha's spirit was likely the first to haunt the property. The sailor from the affected ship was the next to die. His remains were also hastily concealed on the ground. The other six patients remained in the home until they were all well again. Such statistics reflected a most unusual and an impressive rate of recovery for a group attacked by the oft-left plague. Members of the surrounding community, however, focused on the original owner's flight from the area, followed by the two deaths, and determined that the place was somehow inherently evil. The building's reputation as an evil place. Once the six survivors recovered significantly to return to society, the makeshift pest house was abandoned for the second time in its short existence. Victorians, however, continued to give the empty place a wide berth, especially after dark. The few brave souls who did travel past the house on Dallas Road at night were often witnesses to some frightening and probably paranormal sights. From the available descriptions, it would seem that the window and the house were frequently alive with supernatural phenomena. In these fatigue or ghost lights as a mysterious orbs of illumination are now known. Not surprisingly, the house at Berkeley Farm remained unoccupied by the living anyway. No one from the area was interested in tempting fate by moving into the eventually haunted house. About this time, however, an investor who claimed to be from San Francisco arrived in Victoria, calling himself Mr. P. Lackey, a neatly dressed man checked into the Angel Hotel. Over the next few weeks, the newcomer said little about himself until suddenly announcing to the hotel staff that his wife would soon be joining him from England and that he would therefore soon require more permanent accommodation. For reasons that are now unclear, the people at the hotel recommended that he consider residing at the former pest house. Their direction proved fatal. Lackey soon fell victim to the Berkeley Farm jinx. The second last time that the man was seen alive, he was observed in a heated argument near the possessed house. His opponent was a woman whom the witness had never seen before. This disagreement escalated until Lackey was observed recoiling from a vicious slap to the side of the head. When he was seen at the hotel later that day, the last time that anyone saw him alive, the man supported a badly bruised face. Determining the order of the events that followed that appearance was initially somewhat confusing. By February 17, 1873, someone decided to explore the Berkeley Farm property, but both the person's name and motivation for doing so had long been lost to history. These explanations no doubt ended the moment that they revealed the corpse of a shabbily dressed man. Police immediately accused that it was a murderer, as the man had been shot through the head at close range and no weapon could be found. The confusion mounted with the Angel Hotel staff's discovery of a suicide note in one of their rooms. Although it no longer much mattered, the man whom they knew as P. Lackey from San Francisco was actually P. Stalker from Scotland. What did matter now was that he was dead. The note indicated that he intended to shoot himself in the head. Further Billamore erupted when a woman from Nanaimo was reported missing. Stranger still, her description exactly matched that of the woman seen slapping Lackey Stoker's face from Victoria's North. Island residents were stricken with fear. They were sure that there was a murderer loose. It was several days before a series of events began to provide clues to all the mysteries. When a local street urchin tried to sell a gun to a shopkeeper, the man became suspicious and called the police. A quick check determined that the gun was identical to the one that killed the man found on the Berkeley Farm property. The youngster and his relatives were immediately apprehended, realizing that they were about to be accused of a crime much more heinous than the one that they actually committed. The little group hastily confessed the wrongdoing. They had found the well-dressed suicide victim with his gun laying beside him. Determining that the corpse had no use for either the fine clothes or his gun, they revealed him of it all. Then perhaps out of respect for the dead man's dignity, they dressed him in their old clothes and left him that way for the next person along to find. It would not last much longer, however. The haunted, possessed, jinxed, and cursed house shortly afterward transformed itself into a pile of ashes in a mysterious and sudden blaze. Many people were sure that the ghost lights had started the fire. Nobody mourned the loss of the haunted house on Dallas Road. Unbelievably, the evil forces were not yet completely spent. One of the Prince Albert-stricken passengers who had been isolated at the Berkeley Farmhouse had fully recovered and was moving on with her life. Toward the end She sent that dress that she worn on the voyage to the seamstress shop to be altered slightly. According to a May 2, 1953 newspaper report, the dressmaker and several members of the family contracted smallpox from the soiled and infected dress. Their deaths were the final ones recorded as having been associated with the haunted house on Dallas Road. Now, once again, this is my second time to Dallas Road trying to re-record the story, but again, it didn't turn out, so I had to re-record it from home, so hopefully this worked. The reason why it's my second favorite story is because so many events had happened, including smallpox, murder, and so on, that even years later, there was still a curse from the smallpox, and this is one of the reasons why it's my favorite stories. My second one from Victoria, BC. My first one is from Hatley Park Castle, which I actually did a video on. It's actually my very first video, so you can check that out at facebook.com/phantom1831. And hopefully you do enjoy this story and video. And this is actually one of my favorite books that I own, Ghost Stories and Mysterious Creatures of British Columbia by Barbara Smith. There's actually quite a few stories in Victoria that I have followed through this, and I'm trying to locate some of the Vancouver stories so I could do those ones as well. But it is an awesome book, and I hope you enjoy this. And again, thank you for all the donations. For my 40th birthday, it has been an awesome week. If you'd like to donate to either fund my trips, marymartin1588@gmail.com, marymartin1588@gmail.com, or you can donate equipment as well. I really need a new computer, microphone, etc. If there's anything you could donate, just send me a link and let me know. Hopefully more stories will continue. Again, I have been doing this for 2 years and it's still a great hobby and love of mine. And I hope you guys have been enjoying these ghost stories. So once again, this is about haunted and cursed Dallas Road from Ghost Stories and the Mysterious Creatures of British Columbia by Barbara Smith. And once again, this is your host Mary JM from Mary JM's Ghostly Adventures, showing you to BC.
In 1796, a man named Jenner had found a fix to smallpox, one of the most infamous and virulent diseases to ever exist. 1, 2, 3 into the fall. Now, how in the world was it treated before variolation? When you inoculate the smallpox virus into the patient,
it was hoped that you become immune once the symptoms disappeared from you. And though this process enjoyed success, there was still issues had to be addressed.
For example, there was always the risk that the inoculated virus had stayed alive and the smallpox patient didn't survive or the patient infected another life.
Through hard work and determination, Jenner made what's called vaccination, in which smallpox was inoculated with a needle in the arm of a patient. Through hard work and determination, Jenner made what's called vaccination, in which cowpox was inoculated with a needle in the arm of a patient.
Vaccination was safe and effective, not nearly as risky as variolation. It laid down the foundation to what would become the eradication.
In 1796, a man named Jenner had found a fix to smallpox, one of the most infamous and virulent diseases to ever exist.
In 1796, Dr. Jenner vaccinated his first patient, an 8-year-old boy named James Phipps, as he finally became resistant.
Through hard work and determination, Jenner made what's called vaccination, in which cowpox was inoculated with a needle in the arm of a patient. Through hard work and determination, Jenner made what's called vaccination, in which cowpox was inoculated with a needle in the arm of a patient.
The World Health Organization began its campaign for eradication. It was 1961. This was the year it had all begun. On May 18th, 1980, the WHO declared smallpox dead officially. Yeah.
Oh, the damage done by the sword and guns, nothing compared to the smallpox and rum. All over this land there was never a storm with winds of destruction like smallpox and rum. A Sachem proclaimed it, his blanket red. White man's whiskeys will drain you to death. But the lure of the liquor blinded eyes. Decades passed, thousands have died. Oh, the damage done by the sword and guns. Nothing compared to the smallpox and rum. All over this land there was never a storm. With winds of destruction like smallpox and rum.